So in this class, we'll be looking at person and society, the person and society. And you can say a summary of the class, if I want to put it in one sentence, is what you have before you. Man is called to show forth the image of God. The church has the right to speak about the person and society, largely because the church has to do with the human person and that person's salvation. But that person doesn't exist in isolation. It is in a society. And so over time, the church has in proclaiming different aspects of man and how he relates in society, has come up with what we call the social doctrine of the church, which is largely what we are going to see, some ideas that the church proposes to society, we are going to see in this class. And we are going to see this, the person on society, under certain headings. The first, the final end and the dignity of the human person. Then, we'll look at the social character of the person, the society, what society is, authority, the common good, and how to participate in public life. And what we're going to be looking at, we'll cover in this point of the catechism that you have before you on the screen. The final end and dignity of the human person. That God, the first cause of all creation, is also its final end. And even though we say that irrational creatures tend towards this end in a necessary way, but man freely tends towards his own end, which is to know and to love God. A dog, by living as a dog, tends towards its end, which will be to feed itself, to reproduce, to maybe carry out some function like it has been trained to do, and then it's achieving its end, its aim. A plant achieves its aim by following its nature, by growing as a plant. Only a human person decides freely to achieve its end or not, to know and to love God or not. He doesn't achieve it just by following his nature, but he can decide how he wants to achieve, not just if to achieve his end or not, but also the means in which the person wants to use to achieve that end. And that's one of the things that differentiates man from other creatures. But God has willed us not just to a natural end, but even more importantly, to a supernatural end. That supernatural end, which is beyond us, and which, by being supernatural, is that union with Him forever and ever. With that supernatural end, which He helps us to attain through that life of grace. Unfortunately, the man has been wounded by original sin, and even though that supernatural end, he couldn't have attained it by himself, has even become more difficult because of original sin. And for that reason, God gives us His help through the law and through grace. That supernatural grace that strengthens our freedom, that helps us to attain that supernatural end. And man is the only creature on earth that God has wanted for His own sake. And unlike other creatures, man is not just something, but man is someone. Someone that God has wanted for Himself. There's a book that I read some years ago that I always like the way the author put it. He said, well, when you look at, imagine when you want to buy a car or a dress, and you're looking at a catalog of possible cars, or maybe now you're browsing the internet looking for the right specs of a car or equipment that you want to buy. And maybe you get a particular page and you stop and you say, well, this is the car that I want to buy. This is the appliance I want to buy. This is the cloth I want to buy. And the same thing happens in a sense with God in choosing each human being. That there's that infinite catalog of infinite possible human beings. And God, in that sense, analogically flipping through, stops at your page. At that moment, He says, this is a person that I want to create. This is a person that I want to love me forever. Not just for his years on earth, but to love me forever. Eternally, and then you and I came to be. That way that man is not just something, but is someone. For this reason, one should never view persons as mere means to an end. Other creatures are means to an end. Maybe use the dog is a means to maybe secure one's house and provide security, maybe find some things if it's a search dog, companionship. But and a plant has its own function, And other things in creation have their functions that way, but that man, even though he has functions, and maybe we use him, a man can be used for certain things, but that above all, the dignity of man lies in the fact that God has chosen him as an end. And each person should also see men, due persons, not as mere means, not as a person that gives you companionship, but an end to be loved, a person to be loved. Having all that in mind, then this background will give in the difference between man and other creatures. We now enter that social character of the person. The man is not just called to show forth the image of God. He's not just a dignified being, but God being the unity of the Trinity, unity in communion, man is created to exist for others, to become a gift. Man by nature is a social being. Every person possesses that the same nature and the same origin. Everyone has been redeemed by Christ. But society is not for man something an extraneous addition, but a requirement of his nature. Man by nature is social. There's this story that I think I've told in another class, but I will repeat it again. The Empress of Maria Theresa of Austria, who decided to do an experiment, a social experiment, to discover the language of God and natural language of man, or she called it the language of God in her experiment. And there's an orphanage with some children there. So they got the smallest ones who were tender children who were less than 1 year old or just above 1 year old. And they decided to take care of the children, feed them very well. But like, people minding them would not say a single word to them. In that way, they wanted to discover what language the children would develop by themselves in order to communicate and arrive at that natural language or the so-called language of God. But what happened over time? The children, they're dying one by one. Because even though you give them the best food, the best clothes, if you don't communicate with them and if they cannot communicate, they cannot socialize. And if they cannot socialize, they eventually died. Because we weren't in that sense completely. They died one by one. And that experiment ended. Unfortunately, in society, there are some people who come with this notion that it's a notion of a social contract and say that man, the social relations are a construct. That man is independent, man wants to spend on his own. And then one day he decided to come together and form a society. No, the society is something that is a requirement of his nature. He would want to form a society. And knowing that also in that society is the means which man flourishes. The vocation of man is personal, but at the same time, it concerns social life. And what is society? Society is that group of persons bound together organically by a principle of unity that goes beyond each one of them. Society, man is social, and by nature he wants to form a society, a group of persons bound together organically by a principle of unity that goes beyond each one of them. And that principle of unity that goes beyond each one of them binds them together, but at the same time that society exists to help each of the individuals there to flourish. Social relation is needed to flourish. The vocation of man, we said time and again in this class, that is personal, but at the same time concerns social life. And many different human goals exist, as well as bonds that unite people together. Maybe some people come together, like a man and a woman, out of love, and they form that natural society, which is a family, that starts with marriage, and then they have children who are all bound by love. Some people come together out of ethnicity, people of the same or language, or because they are the same country, or because they support the same football club, or they have the same culture, etc. They come, and that principle of unity in that sense is either that love, that ethnicity, that language, that country, the goals they want to promote, whatever it may be. But at the same time, that the human relationships entail that wide mosaic of institutional association, the family, city, state, international community, etc. But there are certain societies which we should say that are more natural, that more correspond to the nature of man, like the family and also the state, which you could say that are almost like a natural society, like this family that I see here or the state. Well, there are also voluntary associations that respond to the human person's natural tendency to socialize, like the maybe a cultural association or a book club or a group of friends, which in a sense that one, like maybe the family, one does not choose one's family members. But certainly in those clubs that one chooses to join the club, or one chooses the members of the club that he wants to be part of that club, or one chooses one's friend. And all these societies help man not just to socialize, but to develop one's qualities. One learns things from them, one learns things from the family, from the state, from this group of friends. And it reminds me of this thing that Catherine of Siena would say, rather that Jesus Christ would say to her in one of her mystical visions. He would ask her a question. He'd say, well, Catherine, why do you think that I've given different qualities to different people at different times? This person has made this person intelligent, this other person maybe is good looking, this other person is very good at playing musical instruments, and so on and so forth. And I've been so omnipotent, I could have given all those qualities to everyone. And then he answers the question. He tells that, well, so that each person would be a minister to the other. And that's where a man, not living in isolation, would also want to socialize, and then each person, by ministering to the others, with one's talent, with one's gift, enriches the other person and is also enriched by the qualities of the other. And I think it's a very nice way to think of society, those voluntary associations, and even the ones that which are more natural, like the family and the state. They are places where people develop and reach that full capacity, that human flourishing that God has ordained that we develop through society. Every society, as we've said earlier on, is defined by its end and has its own specific rules, maybe a club rules or class rules or school rules. And the human person, by the same time, the human person is and ought to be the beginning, the subject, and the object of every social organization. The human person that is there is not just a subject there or okay, an object to be used by the society. As unfortunately happens in some groups, that maybe they turn each of the individuals there as pawns for a game or as people sacrifice for the society. No, society or that social group exists for the individuals that form the association. And in as much as those individuals develop, then there's progress in society. At the same time, each person rightly owes loyalty to the communities of which he is part and respect to those in authority of that society. So the people of authority in that society are not meant to use the individuals as pawns for a kind of game or sacrifice them for the end of society. At times it happens maybe in a communist regime that the individuals or a socialist regime, the individuals do not have any rights. They are not the important thing is the state. Or the society, or the group. Individuals do not count, and they can sacrifice the individuals, their dignity, just to advance the ends of that group. Then we're also important to see, within looking at the society, the so-called principle of subsidiarity, which says that a community of a higher order should not interfere in the life of a community of a lower order, depriving the latter of its function, but rather should support it in case of need and help to coordinate its activity with the activities of the rest of society, always with a view to the common good. This first principle, which is a very important principle in Catholic social doctrine, is for the, not just for the common good, but respects the dignity of the persons in society. The community of a higher order should not interfere in the life of a community of a lower order. What does this mean? For example, maybe in a street, the road is bad. Now, if the people in that street can fix the road, then there's no need to involve a higher order society, which may be the local government or the state government or the federal government. And because it's more, they will fix it in a way, for example, that will be suited to their needs and also support their dignity. is less dignified if they have to start waiting for, I don't know, maybe the federal government to come and fix that road. But I said, if they can, because there are certain competencies that one needs a higher order of society to take care of. Maybe, for example, supply possible water to the state. People on the street may not be able to do that by themselves because they don't have enough resources. So the important thing there is that there are certain things that maybe at a smaller or a lower level of society, people can do. And the higher level society should foster that initiative of the lower levels and not take, for example, things that those of the lower level can do or frustrate them from doing it. That's the principle of subsidiarity. And that can apply to many societal activities. Maybe, of course, in a home, the parents can decide to train their children in a certain way. But they realize that maybe at a certain point, there's something that cannot teach the children. And so they now have to go to a higher level of society, maybe the community now, to teach the children in certain skills. So they go to that higher level of society. And that higher level of society should also help to foster, to empower the parents to take care of the things they can take care of. And that's the principle of subsidiarity. And that can apply to many things. And what the point there is that it fosters the dignity of the individuals of the lower society and also makes things to function much easier. So as you see in this chart, how the principle of subsidiarity works. What the individual can take care of, should take care of it. What the family can, it should take care of it. What the community can, and then we go up to a higher level, the town, the country, the state, or the federal government of the country. And so at different levels, each one should be allowed to take care of it. One can take care of being fostered and being also helped by the higher level of society in order to respect the dignity of man at each level. Now, still looking at society, is also true that unfortunately, as a result of sin, there are unjust structures, or what we call structures of sin that have arisen in society. And these structures of sin render the practice of virtue more difficult. That's what a structure of sin does. A structure that renders the practice of virtue more difficult, or makes it easier to commit personal sins. And they are opposed in themselves to the right order of society. A typical structure of sin will be maybe in an office, that a person cannot get a particular favor in a particular office without paying a bribe. And that bribe collecting structure becomes a structure of sin, that the person cannot do the right thing, offer a service without having to, or receive a service without having to pay a bribe. Another structure of sin there are many structures of sin that could exist, that of having to pay bribes to get to move forward, or a structure of sin that maybe in a particular society, that in order to advance, or a particular organization, in order to advance, one, unfortunately, happens in some sectors, one must give sexual favors to another group, and that becomes a structure of sin. Or in order to move forward, advancing one's career in a company, that one must do some shady deals or do some corrupt practices in order to move forward. And it's like a standard. A person who does not want to do that, maybe it's frustrated or it makes it difficult. So that's that structure of sin that renders the practice of virtue more difficult or makes it easier to commit personal sin. Now, in order to have just structures, a society needs just person. And in order to overcome or to eliminate the structures of sin, there has to be a group of people who are good, first of all, because those structures of sin arose because they were bad people, they were unjust people, who are good, first of all, and then who, with their efforts, say with their diligence, try and eventually eliminate those structures of sin. And so it's important, why are we talking about this, is that the norms of professional morality are important, that people should have clear ideas, and people shouldn't say that, well, here in our work, we don't talk about morality. Morality is for the church. No, a man is a moral being. And so even in his professional work, there is good and there is evil. And if he takes care to do his work well, honestly, then he will eliminate those structures of sin. Now we'll look at the third, a very important element of society, which is authority. In the Catechism defines authority. He talks about authority when he says that every human community needs an authority to govern it. The foundation of such authority lies in human nature, and so is necessary for the unity of the state. Its role is to ensure as far as possible the common good of society. So we could say in summary that the authority exists for the unity of the state and for the common good of the society. The authority is that symbol of unity of the state, of the organization, not necessarily a state. Is the symbol of unity, or maybe a company will be the CEO or the head of that company. So the authority exists for the unity of that organized societal group, and also to promote the common good of society, of that societal group. Every human community needs an authority to govern it. And the foundation of such authority, because if there's no unity, there's disunity, there's chaos. They don't know who is in charge. And the foundation of such unity lies in human nature, as we've read in that point. And while it's necessary for the unity of the state, its role is to ensure, as far as possible, the common good of that society. St. Paul, in his letter to the Romans, would point out very clearly that all authority comes from God. And even our Lord would say to Pilate, that you will not have no authority over me if it had not been given to you from above. All authority comes from God. Authority is not something that one arrogates to himself in order to achieve one's personal end, but authority is something that has been given in order to achieve, to promote the common good of that society. But it's true that at the same time that the choice of the political regime and the appointment of rulers are left to the free decisions of the citizens. It's true that even though it comes from God, that God permits, you know, or if you say the instrument of God granting it to whoever it may be, is true. The free decision of the citizens in certain cases, or the members of the group. So maybe through an election or through an appointment, or maybe they rotate presidency or authority as the case may be. And the word God uses those, whatever means that one political citizen that one chooses. And so for that reason, one of the things that the church says about political systems is that the political systems, people are free to choose whatever political system they want. The church does not promote any political system as being better than the other or being ordained by God and some others, no. So anything that the church says about political systems while leaving them people free to choose whatever they want is to say that, well, that the church, while it's a democratic system, in as much, and maybe emphasis on that word, in as much, as it ensures the participation of the citizens. Because the democratic system may be unlike the monarchy and oligarchy, where few people choose with an authority. The democratic system, by its nature, where everybody can vote or should be able to vote, everybody of a certain age can vote, shows by its nature the dignity of each person. It doesn't say that you have less dignity, and so we are not interested in what you think of who should rule. It shows the dignity that each person has that dignity, because each person is made in the image and likeness of God. And so the church values it in as much as it ensures participation of citizens, because it shows that dignity of the human person. So that, but at the same time, democracy stands or falls with the values that it embodies of and promotes. Democracy is not an end in itself. You can have everybody saying that something is wrong is right, and then the democracy has failed. It only makes sense if whether democracy, if what it promotes is good. Some years ago, Pope Benedict XVI went to the German parliament, and then there he addressed them, and one of the things he pointed out to them, this is not verbatim, he quoted St. Augustine, where he pointed out to them that that a group of thieves can have a democracy. They can decide to vote, and this is what St. Augustine was saying, like a group of robbers can decide to vote for who will be their head, and also vote who they are going to rob. And they will call themselves a democratic institution, because they're effectively, they are very, very democratic about what exactly they want to do. But what they are doing is evil. In the same way, too, a group of parliamentarians can decide to say that what is wrong is right. And even though they all vote for it, what is wrong, even if only one person votes against it and all others vote for it, and what is right. So democracy is not an end in itself, but democracy is a means to an end. And if democracy does not promote the right values or embody it, then it's useless. The authority mustn't behave in a despotic manner because he exists for the common good. And the person who is in charge, the authority, is only exercised legitimately when it seeks the common good, not when it seeks its own end. And it's only legitimate if it employs morally legitimate means to attain it. Because at times it may seek the common good, but it may do it by using terrible means. The authority cannot do evil so that good will come out of it. The authority may tolerate evil, which is a different thing. That maybe there's a certain aspect, some things, some laws that are there that are bad, and that the authority made there, and well, it cannot change now. And so it tolerates them while trying to see how to change them. But not that the authority will now go and start doing evil things, maybe taking a person's land unjustly so that they want to build a structure that is very good. The authority can never do evil, or it can tolerate evil that it meets, or that it cannot do anything about immediately. It's a very important principle to keep very much in mind. And if rulers were to enact unjust laws or take measures contrary to the moral order, then the people will have the right to protest, and people will have the right to rebel, as we saw in the fourth commandment. Well, it's also true that at times authority can sometimes choose not to put a stop to something evil. As we already said, they tolerate it while it already exists, and there's not much they can do about it. But they can never presume to legitimize it as right and say that this is right, they tolerate it. But at the same time, they cannot do evil, they cannot commit evil and say that it is good. And then finally, we arrive at the last part of this class, which is the common good. What is the common good? The common good, and we've heard that many times, is a term that maybe sometimes is difficult to define. But the Catechism defines it as this, as the sum total of social conditions, which allow people, either as groups or as individuals, to reach their fulfillment more fully and more easily. It is sum total of social conditions. It's not just a higher salary, is not just more freedom, is not just good roads or good water, but it's some total of social conditions that allow the individual or groups to reach their flourishing more easily and more fully. Usually in classical Catholic social doctrine, usually we find it with three terms, with three broad groups, so that to make it more concrete. First of all, is the respect for the person and his freedom. Secondly, that social welfare and integral human development. And then thirdly, to foster peace. In a society, we have that respect for the person and his freedom, and that freedom to apply for a job or to move around or to achieve one's personal target. Of course, freedom which is not licensed. License would be chaos and anarchy. It's a certain freedom that is respectable, and I respect the freedom of others. I may have a society that maybe has that freedom, but lacks peace. Maybe a police state, where people are at war, and so but they don't respect the freedom of people, but maybe they are at war. Or you may have a society in which the second term, that's number two there, social welfare and integral human development, which is where many of the things that maybe people ordinarily from poor countries think of, that social welfare, good roads, good amenities, integral human development, good education, etc. You may have that maybe in a rich state, but that state does not respect the freedom of its individual, their freedom of conscience, or is a kind of police state, and so there's no real peace. And so the common good is all that. That's personal freedom, not license, social welfare and integral human development, and then it also fosters peace. And then one last point, of course, that integral human development has to, it's not just that a person gets a good education, not that a person can advance and enter the society that he chooses, but it's also important that society also respects the transcendence of the human person, that the person has a soul, that the person also, that human development is not just material development, but also spiritual development. Which leads to the last point of, this is actually the last point of this class. That part of that common good is also to participate in public life. She's helping to foster that common good, each according to his or her position and role, has an obligation to participate in public life. It's not something that I'm doing the society of people by participating in public life. I have a duty to participate in public life, which is because it's part of the dignity of the human person. Primarily by means of the responsible fulfillment of one's own family and professional duties, I participate in public life. When I take care of my family duties, I'm already helping for the other members of my side to develop, and I'm participating in public life. When I take care of my professional duties, as a teacher, a worker, a farmhand, whatever it is, I'm participating in public life, first of all. But also, it's important to, as far as possible, that citizens should take an active part also in social office, I'll call it that, in that social office. Taking care to be concerned about the people that rule, the people that govern, because it's part of that vocation of the lay faith. And taking care of that involves several things. It involves, making sure that one votes and that one fights on just laws. It's not enough to wait for a law to come first and be unjust, and then we start fighting it. And so, besides fighting unjust laws, it's also important that one also promotes good laws through campaigning, or maybe through a friend that maybe wants to push a particular law, and then we see how to get consensus and support that person. And it's also important, of course, within the common good, that people also lead that principle of solidarity, which is different from the principle of subsidiarity. And that solidarity simply means, of course, that we help the people who are in need, because society cannot fulfill the common good. This second point, sorry, I'm going back. That social welfare, integral human development, is the authority cannot guarantee that everywhere, because there are certain places, we say, gaps that it cannot meet. And how will it meet it? Through the individual initiative of people that realize that this person is poor, or that this person needs company, or that this person needs help. And that, we call it simply maybe making living charity, giving alms, making a visit to the poor, helping the sick, because society, even in a perfect welfare state, cannot meet the needs of everyone. Sometimes they meet their material needs, but they don't meet their spiritual needs. They don't meet their emotional needs. And there is only Christian charity that can fulfill that gap that social justice or social welfare cannot meet. This is at an individual level, but also maybe at times also that countries, rich countries also have that principle of solidarity, means that rich countries also should help poor countries, and not just out of PR, but that they have a duty to help poor countries. Also, that participation in public life is to keep that very much in mind, which may be to vote, to get consensus so that good people are voted for, or to come at ourselves, vote for me, to be voted for. Because if bad people rule, it's only because good men have been silent. With this, we end this class. May God bless you.